morning again.
Good morning.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
How many of you watched the ball drop?
Oh, wow.
A lot of you did. I was in bed at 7.
No.
Not really, almost 7. God bless you for having the wherewithal to stay up that late. I'm past that, so you'll have to send me a video. Just a few things. First of all, if you are interested in the puppet ministry, please meet with Laura in my office right after the service. Those of you who would like to participate, would like to be a part of that ministry, please meet with her just for a few minutes. I'd like to meet with the deacons and trustees right after the service right up here. And I want to share something with you that I think is wonderful. I put an idea box out in the fellowship hall on the table. Now, somebody decided to put garbage and wrappers in there. Anyway, those were not good ideas. It all began with Sherry coming up with this idea about sharing her testimony. She has shared her testimony without using her name, just inconspicuously, and typed it up and printed it and put it in these colorful envelopes for you to be able to share with somebody that you're sharing the Lord with, her testimony, which is powerful. We would encourage you to also do the same thing. I think it's a wonderful idea. Just write your testimony out and put it in a nice colored envelope for someone who might be able to utilize it and, again, understand how your life has been impacted by the Lord. It's a great idea. Thank you, Sharon, for this. And I encourage you to do the same. Also, if you have any ideas, just put them in the idea box and we can take a look at that and, again, just implement it if we can. Don't forget what happened to Billy Graham. Don't forget what happened to Billy Graham. Each one.
Yes.
Each one, reach one. Grab a gospel, grab a track, and let's get the word out. All right, with that being said, let us turn to the Word of God. This morning our scripture reading will be from the Epistle of Paul to the Corinthian Church. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Let us stand as we read the Word of God. First Corinthians 1, beginning at verse 1. Paul, called by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and all knowledge, even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end, guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. May God bless the reading of his holy word. You may be seated. God is faithful. All the time.
Amen. All the time. God is faithful.
All the time.
God is faithful.
God is faithful.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is faithful.
God is faithful.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
What a wonderful way to start off the new year. Understanding and comprehending the faithfulness of God. Very important for us to do that, to remember that God is always faithful. These three words, they arouse comfort and courage and just confidence, knowing that God is faithful. Amen?
Amen?
God is faithful. He's always faithful. Now, it's interesting how Paul addresses the Corinthian church. You're all familiar with what was going on in the Corinthian church. They were having problems and troubles, and things were going on in that church that the Apostle Paul really kind of lays in on them as we go through the epistle of 1 Corinthians, even 2 Corinthians. And yet, look at how beautifully he begins the letter. No mention of their lacking, no mention of their faults. He helps them by first encouraging them to understand that God is faithful. And then he goes on in the epistle to apply God's faithfulness to their problems. God is faithful. You have the outline in your bulletin. Point number one, God's character is faithful. God's character is faithful. 1 Corinthians 1:9, God is faithful. Character describes our traits. Character describes what a person is like or what a type is like. For example, our church, the sanctuary, during the Christmas season is beautiful. That is a character, a trait of what our church looks like. That's character, and it also has a very deep and important meaning in the fact that it's used not only just to describe traits, but it's also used as the way that people communicate. You've heard of the alphabet called, these are characters, or numbers, these are characters. It's the permanent way that they are. A is always A, B is always B. This is the character of God, always constant. God is faithful. His faithfulness characterizes who he is, just like his holiness. God is faithful. God is holy. And as we go through the Bible and study the Bible, we see that these attributes of God are upheld by the fact that he is faithful. God is faithful. Number one, it's an attribute of God. God is absolutely, totally, completely reliable. There's no question about God's faithfulness. And he's also constantly faithful. Scripture is filled with figures of speech that represent this divine stability and steadfastness. In the Old Testament, we read about the extensiveness of God's faithfulness. The extensiveness of God's faithfulness. Psalm 36, verse 5. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Think about it. The faithfulness of God extends into the heavens, past beyond the clouds. That is extensive. That is the nature and the character of God's faithfulness. Not only is his faithfulness extensive, it's also everlasting. The everlastingness of God's faithfulness. Psalm 119, verse 90. Your faithfulness endures to all generations. You've established the earth and it stands fast. God is always faithful. He's never not faithful. It's everlasting and it endures to all generations of humanity. God is faithful. And what I've titled the exceedingness of God's faithfulness. Lamentations 3, 22 and 23. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. You see it? Great is your faithfulness. It is exceedingly great. It is everlastingly great. It is extensively great. The greatness of God's faithfulness to you and to me never ceases. It's new every single morning. Again, when we understand this attribute, this character of God, we discover that it falls in place with all of the other attributes that God has. This faithfulness is key. Not only is it an attribute of God, it's also an activity of God. An activity of God. An attribute of God, an activity of God. 1 Corinthians 1:9, God is faithful. God's activity in faithfulness. One of the great doctrines of the Bible and the Holy Scriptures is God's covenant loyalty with those who are his children. His covenant loyalty. That combination of words throughout the Old Testament describes God's faithfulness, and they imply a determined faithfulness even to Israel and towards his people. Steadfast. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 9. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. How often did Israel stray? How often did Israel sin? Do you realize what Israel did in the Old Testament? The many, many times they would say, "Yes, we're with you, Lord." And then they would rebel. Even to such rebellion where they became involved in Baal worship. The rebellion and the sinfulness of Israel throughout the Old Testament is clearly seen. And yet God, because of his covenant with them, with Israel, with Abraham, the Abrahamic covenant, because of that covenant, God remained faithful. He remained faithful. Those who broke God's promises and God's word paid consequences. But for those who repented and would come back to God, God remained faithful and he kept that covenant loyalty with them. Peter, in Matthew 18:21, Peter says, Peter comes up to Jesus and he says to Jesus, "How often will my brother sin against me and I will forgive him? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you 7 times, but 70 times 7. The forgiveness that we ought to have to one another, the same type of forgiveness that God extends to you and to me. God is always forgiving as long as we come to him and we repent of our sin and return from that sin. God is willing to forgive. There's an interesting story of a boy who was crossing the ocean with his father on an ocean liner. During the voyage, the ship ran into a horrible, horrible storm. I mean, it was tossing this boat back and forth. I'm sorry, it's a ship, it's not a boat.
Yeah.
Very big difference.
Yeah.
I learned that from Columbo. It's a ship tossed back and forth. Horrible waves, huge waves. And yet this little boy was constantly looking at this one window. And as they were going through the storm, he was cool as a cucumber. It's pretty cool. And he kept his eye on the window. Finally, one of the passengers came up to him and said, "Why are you so cool in the midst of this horrific storm? And why do you keep looking through that window?" And the little boy said to him, "I keep looking through that window because I can see my father. And my father is the captain of this ship. And we've been through storms like this before, and I know we're going to make it again." He kept his eye on the father who controlled the ship.
Yes.
He paid no attention to the storm and the waves and what was happening around him because he had confidence in his father to be able to do what his father did best. God's faithfulness is the same way. We must remember that the faithfulness of God is both an attribute and activity. He chooses to maintain that faithfulness with you and with me. Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Our God and Father, we thank you for both this attribute of yours and your activity, that you are faithful. And Lord, as we move into this new year, we ask that you would help us to keep our eyes focused on you at all times, no matter what happens, because you are faithful all the time. Help us, Lord, to know and be assured and rest and be in comfort and confident that as we begin this new year, you will be faithful. You always have been, and you always will be. Help us to remain faithful to you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's turn now in our hymnals to our communion hymn, number 308. 308. Let us stand as we sing. Before we partake. And so let's take a few moments in silent prayer and just make sure that we've confessed our sins to Him, that we've repented of our ways, and that we ask Him to fill us with His Holy Spirit as we partake of these elements. Let us pray. Father, this morning we come before you and we ask for forgiveness. We know that you are faithful and that when we confess our sins to you, you forgive and you cleanse us from all unrighteousness because of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, none of us is perfect. We're well aware of that. And we know that the church is not filled with perfect people. Rather, we come to this place as your children, broken and hurting, rejoicing and glorifying, thankful to you that in this place you have chosen to minister to our hearts by your Holy Spirit. Lord, help us to be conformed to your image. Give us the strength and the encouragement to be more like Jesus. And now as we partake of these elements, this table, Lord Jesus, that you have set before us, help us to be mindful of what you've done on our behalf. We ask it in your name. Amen. Jesus was seated at the table with his disciples after Judas had left. He took the bread and he passed it amongst his own. And he said to them, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Let us partake." this time of the year when we have celebrated your birth. We understand why you came. You lived a perfect, sinless life. You fulfilled the law. You were holy and righteous in everything you did, loving and caring for all those around you. And yet you sacrificed your body to sinful man, to nail you to a cross, that you might be the payment for our wrongdoing. A great love has been manifested in the giving of your body for our redemption. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. After they had taken the bread, Jesus passed the cup. And he said to his beloved, "This is the cup of the New Testament, and it's shed and poured out for your sins. Let us partake." Thank you, Lord, for remaining on the cross, for not wavering, for being faithful, for choosing to pay for each and every one of our sins, so that in you we might be made righteous, that because of you, we can stand before a holy God and know and be confident that we have been called the sons and daughters of Almighty God. Thank you, Lord, for the fact that you are the way and the truth and the life. And we can come to you, Father, through him. We praise you, Almighty God, for your wondrous plan in saving us and giving us new life and a new way. And as we begin this new year, to live for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us stand now for our closing video, We Believe.
In this time of desperation, all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. In this broken generation, dark, you help us.
faithful.
All the time.
And he's coming back again.
Amen.
Could be today. Father God, we are so, so thankful for who you are. Thank you for picking us up. Thank you for filling us with your Holy Spirit. Thank you for showing us the way. We praise you, Lord God. We ask now that you would fill us with your peace, with your hope, with your joy as we leave this place, that we might shine forth, that people might see you in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.